Hi guys, welcome to RBI 247. As you all know, my name is Mansi Anand, your mentor for competitive exams. So guys, in these sessions called RBI 247, we try to discuss some concepts that can be of use to you if you are preparing for any competitive exam, right? So as you all know, we discussed 5 questions. So today we were not able to have a live session at our regular time, that is 9 a.m. due to some technical issues. And that is why we are putting this recorded video up. So I hope this video will benefit you. So are you ready for question number 1? But before moving to question number 1, I would like to ask you guys to subscribe to our channel anujindal.in, and subscribing to our channel can help you with access to a lot of good content. And if you haven't subscribed till now, please do it now. That is going to help you a lot. After that, don't forget to join our Telegram group. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries. We'll get back to you as soon as possible. Okay. Here is your first question for today. And this question says, so read it carefully. In an economy, the real estate sector is crashing. The regulators are thinking of some measures to boost this sector. From the options given below, select an option which the regulator should not opt for if they want to boost this sector. So very simple question. I think you can relate it with current economic situation of India, since real estate sector is going south. So basically, imagine that you are the regulator of the country, you are in a position and you have decision to make power. Which of the following options would you definitely not recommend to boost this sector? So you have to tell which of the following option can have an adverse impact, right? So moving ahead to correct solution for this question, and the correct solution is B. So B, in option B, it is written raising stamp duty. So guys, अब आप ध्यान रखो कि यहाँ पे real estate sector की बात हो रही है कि हम property के sector को कैसे boost कर सकते हैं, right? So first of all, lowering stamp duty. So if the regulators, they are going to lower the stamp duty, that is going to make purchase of a property cheaper, right? So obviously, what is stamp duty? Stamp duty is a kind of charge that you have to pay when you register any document. अगर आपने कोई भी agreement किया है, आप उसको register कराना चाहते हैं, basically उस पर एक legal ठप्पा लगवाना चाहते हैं कि ये अब एक legally valid document है. तो on that document, for registering that document, you have to pay a charge which is known as stamp duty, right? So if the stamp duty will be lower, then the purchase of the property or the agreement for the purchase of the property is going to be less costlier or cheaper, right? So that is why lowering stamp duty is going to benefit the sector by making the transaction cost lesser, right? After that, raising stamp duty. Raising stamp duty is going to have an adverse impact because it is going to raise the cost of buying a property. That is why a big no-no to this. After this, providing subsidy to property buyers. So if government comes up with a scheme in which they say, okay, we are providing the buyers of real estate with some subsidy, obviously that is going to reduce cost for them and develop their interest in buying property. So a perfectly valid measure. After that, reducing the policy rates. Now, if the regulator reduce the policy rates, that is going to make borrowing cheaper in the economy. That means you can buy a house, and if you want to buy that house by taking that loan is cheaper now because of the fallen policy rates, right? So I hope it's very simple to connect and now you understand it. So reduction of policy rates, not only real estate, it can generally boost the borrowing because it makes the cost of funds lesser, right? After that, central bank buying the bonds of housing finance company to infuse capital into them. So if the central bank they buy bonds of housing finance company, then what happens is that these housing finance companies, what are housing finance companies? HFCs are basically those companies providing loans for buying real estate or providing loans for buying houses in simple term. So obviously, if these companies are well capitalized, that is going to lead to more lending in the economy, and more lending means more purchase of more houses, since more people are going to borrow the money, right? So apart from B, all other options are correct. And this question is in relation to a recent decision by a state government, that is Maharashtra, which recently decided to reduce the stamp duty by 3% till 31st December and by 2% from 1 January 2021 to 31st March 2021. So till next year, some reduction in the stamp duty has been provided, right? So rest you can see what are the stamp duty rates in Maharashtra currently in different cities of Maharashtra. And real estate sector in our country, as you all know, is suffering from unsold inventory. That means builders are so much in worry, so much in tension because they are not able to sell their property. So do give it a thought. Do you think that in such uncertain times, because of the outbreak of COVID, anyone is going to buy the property? So obviously governments have to take some measures, right? Although this decision is favorable, but there is some criticism about it too. Some experts are saying that this is a very minor reduction in the cost of a house or cost of a property, and this might not be enough to develop the interest of the buyers, right? But if developers are ready to provide some discount, and then these double benefits, reduction in stamp duty and discount provided by the developers, these combined measures can result in some action in the real estate sector, right? But after this move, shares of many real estate companies moved upwards. So that shows a positive sign by the investors, right? Positive receival of news by the investors, right? I hope we can move to question number two. And here is your question number two for today, which says, according to RBI guidelines, ARCs are exempted from the limit of holding -% in equity in a borrower after debt to equity conversion if they meet certain norms, right? So this is in a recent decision which has been taken by RBI, or a recent step that has been taken by RBI. So I'll give you a hint. This is in relation to UVARCL. So moving ahead to the correct option for this question, and the correct option is D. So all those of you who answered as D, you guys are absolutely right. So see, what is the decision? Here we are talking about Aircel. So if you remember, there used to be a telecom company called Aircel. You must have seen some advertisements on television some 2-3 years back of Aircel. So in February 2018, Aircel filed for bankruptcy. It was under financial distress. That is why it went to the regulators that please help us. We are not able to manage our finances and repay our loans. Now, Association of ARC in India, a body representing ARCs. What is the meaning of ARCs? Asset Reconstruction Companies. So in simple terms, ARCs are those companies. So they basically have the job of buying the borrower means a company which is in debt, which is unable to pay its debt. So let's say there is a company which is unable to pay its debt. It can be bought by an ARC which is an expert in handling its finances. So it usually, what it does is it tries to balance the finances of that borrower, that non-performing asset, and then turn it into good financial health and then sell it to other companies, right? So UV Asset Reconstruction Company, this is an ARC which was interested in buying this bankrupt telecom company, the Aircel Group, right? So RBI recently rejected their proposal regarding acquisition of the Aircel Group. Now, why has RBI rejected this? Because RBI is saying that the plan which is put up by this ARC, the resolution plan, what is a resolution plan? A plan in which they are going to tell the regulators that, okay, we are an ARC, we have the job of turning this bad asset around, and this is how we are going to do it. So basically a plan in which they tell the activities that they are going to undertake, right? So ab RBI kya keh raha hai ki ye jo aapne plan hame diya hai, this plan submitted by UVARCL, it does not confirm to SARFAESI Act. So guys, we have already discussed SARFAESI Act in one of our previous videos. Simply, it refers टू सिक्योरिटाइजेशन एंड रिकंस्ट्रक्शन ऑफ फाइनेंशियल एसेट एंड इन्फोर्समेंट ऑफ सिक्योरिटी इंटरेस्ट एक्ट. बेसिकली इट रेफर्स टू एन एक्ट विच हैंडल्स ऑल द केसेस रिलेटेड टू ऑल दोज कंपनीज वेयर फाइनेंशियल एसेट्स हैव टू बी सोल्ड टू पे बैक द क्रेडिटर्स, राइट. सो आर बी आई इज सेइंग दिस प्लान डज नॉट फॉलो ऑल द रूल्स अंडर द सारफेसी एक्ट. नाउ आर बी आई इज प्राइमरी ऑब्जेक्शन इज वॉट आर बी आई इज सेइंग दैट ARC, this UVARCL company, it is interested in buying the equity in the company, not debt in ARCL. So, see guys, understand, usually that the central bank, it wants ARC to buy the debt of the company. Why? To relieve the stress of those creditors, right? See, equity holders, they are the owners of the company. They are not the creditors of the company. I hope we are clear with this basic terms that equity holders, they are the owners of the company, so they have share in profits and losses of the company. But the debt holders or the debenture holders, the bond holders, they are the creditors who have to be paid back. So if an ARC is going to buy the debt, that means they are going to pay off the creditors. But if they are investing in equity, then these debt holders, they might or might not get their payment back. So, inka payment latak sakta hai. That is why RBI has doubts over this proposition. I hope now you get it. So, in 2017, RBI came up with a rule. Earlier, there used to be a limit of 26% on buying equity by an ARC, right? So, as you can see here, ARCs had a limit of 26% on equity buying in a borrower. But in 2017, RBI exempted all those ARC if they met certain condition. And these conditions also included compliance to SARFAESI Act. So some good conditioned ARCs, if they are compliant of the rules and regulations and the conditions put up by the central bank, then they can buy more than 26%. So this exemption was provided, but only to the ARCs with good financial health and law compliant ARCs, right? And since now RBI is saying that the proposal of UVARCL is not conforming to the rules of SARFAESI Act, that is why we are not allowing it or we are not accepting it. They involved buying a stake of 76% in the equity of the company, right? So I hope now you are clear with this question. So there were comments on the videos about, so many of you wanted me to discuss the article which was there in Live Mint regarding RBI's rejection of proposal of UVARCL. So I hope all those of you who wanted me to discuss it are clear with it. So guys, moving ahead to third question for today, and this question talks about a recent decision which has been taken by GST Council. I think most of us would be familiar with it. So, in this decision, the GST Council has decided to help states which are suffering from a shortfall of funds. As you all know, our states are starving for funds. They need money to revive the economy, right? So, they have taken a decision, and in relation to that decision, you have to select the correct statement out of these five. So, let's see who gets the correct answer. So, moving ahead to the correct option for this question, and the correct option is A. So, all those of you who have answered as A, you guys are absolutely right. Now, very simple, states are facing huge losses because of two reasons, basically because of double reasons. The first reason being that there is a shortfall or there is a fall in GST collections of the state. So, when the indirect tax regime was shifted from the older methods to the GST method, then the central government, it said that, okay, see guys, under GST things were made more uniform. One nation, one tax, if you remember, this has been the catchphrase of GST, that all the entire country, it should be taxed uniformly. There should be no differences in taxing amongst different states. So basically states are losing power on taxation. They cannot decide the taxation rules by themselves, and they have to be dependent upon the central government for this, right? So now every state they have different conditions. So now if the state government does not have the power of making the policies, the taxation policies by themselves, and they said to central government that okay, we are giving the power to you for decision making, but what if we face a shortfall in tax collections because of shifting to a new regime, then what will we do? Because central government is not very clear about the conditions which are present in individual state once they try to decide the policies for the entire country, right? So in that case, central government told them, okay, whatever shortfall you see in your collections because of the shift to newer regime, to shift to GST, we are going to fund you with it, right? Now the first reason is because of fall in GST collections. After that, the second reason, the loss or the shortfall that states are facing is because of very obvious COVID-19 pandemic, COVID-induced lockdown, right? So now what central government has done to help state governments is divide this loss into two categories. A total of about 3 trillion rupees, 3 trillion loss is being faced by the states. The central government has divided it into two categories. Category 1, 97,000 crore, which they think is because of shortfall in the GST collections, and the central government is liable to compensate state government for this loss, right? As you can see here. After that, the category 2, which is attributable to COVID fallout. So now the central government is saying we cannot do anything, we cannot help it, because it's an unforeseen circumstance, it's a black swan event. No one could have predicted that something like this is about to happen. That is why it's an act of God and is not covered under the compensation pact by central government to states. So a borrowing facility has been provided to the central government, to the state government, that they can borrow this much amount, but this is not going to be funded by the center, right? So under this window, state governments can borrow an extra amount of 2.35 trillion, which is an estimated loss owing to the COVID-induced lockdown. So guys, now moving ahead to the fourth question for today, which says, according to RBI, in a bond auction which was held at 28th August, primary dealers bought bonds worth 17,980 crores, while only 16.2 crore worth of bonds were sold to others. Now consider this statement and select the reason behind underwriters buying most of the bonds in the auction. So guys, see what is happening. RBI decided to sell some bonds to raise money on 28th August. But most of these bonds were bought by the underwriters, not by the other buyers. So who are underwriters? Who are in an agreement or who are in a contract to buy the bonds if they are not bought by the general public or the other institutional buyers, right? So obviously, you have to tell why underwriters had to buy the bonds and why did general public did not show interest into these bonds. Now moving ahead to the correct option for this question, and the correct option is C. So all those of you who answered as C, you guys are absolutely right. See, the simple answer is that the buyers, they wanted a higher rate of return which RBI was not willing to pay. On 28th August, in a bond auction, RBI declined to pay the higher returns demanded by investors. So why did RBI not want to pay the higher return? There is a reason behind it. So we have been discussing it since many months that RBI wants to keep the interest rates lower. It wants that the interest rate should be lesser because in order to enable cheaper lending in the economy, right? So they want to keep the interest rates lower. But if RBI would have agreed to the rates that investors wanted, then they could have led to a spike in the interest rates. Here you can see, government had planned to sell the bonds maturing in 2030 bearing a coupon rate of 5.77% coupon rate, with the regular payments which are made to bondholders, periodic payments, at a yield of 6.1448%, which was being estimated at 6.22%. So the investors, they wanted a yield of around 6.22%. So yield means the total reward which an investor makes on the investment. And RBI was planning to pay around 6.1448%, right? So clearly investors wanted a higher return, which was not acceptable to RBI. So RBI did not wanted to sell the bonds at higher rates. So guys, see, these government bonds, they are basically a base for setting interest rates of different contracts. That is why if this is going to rise, then there is going to be an obvious increase in the interest rates for other borrowers too, and it wants to keep the interest rates lower, right? So result was disinterest of buyers in buying bonds worth 18,000 crore. That is why most of them had to be bought by the underwriters, and investors did not want to buy it. So there is one more point, that why did investors want a higher rate of return. So see guys, we have been discussing that the central bank and its monetary policy committee, is they are a little worried about the rising chances of inflation, that inflation could rise in the economy, right? So that is why, see, the higher the inflation, the more compensation would a lender want from the borrower. See, if you know that, see, if one of your friend asks you for some money to borrow, let's say one of your friend, he asks you to borrow rupees 10,000. Now, if you know that the inflation is going to rise fast, so aapko pata hai, mehengai zyada badhne wali hai. That means if you can buy something from that 10,000 rupees now, you might not be able to do it in the future when your friend returns you that amount, right? So that is why if inflation is higher, then lenders want a higher compensation for the money lent. That is why, since there are talks about rising inflation, lenders want a higher rate of return. I hope now you are clear with this question. Why did lenders want a higher rate of return, and why is RBI not agreeing to do that? Because it wants to keep borrowing easier in the economy. Right, moving ahead to the last question for today. This is the last question, which says Phillips curve is an economic concept that describes the relationship between dash and dash. Very simple question, talks about an economic concept. Moving ahead to the correct option for this question, and the solution is A. So all those of you who answered as A, you guys are absolutely right. This is a curve which talks about the relationship between inflation and unemployment. And what do you think the relation between them is? Do they share a direct relationship? That means if one rises, the other also rises, that they follow similar direction. Or do you think they move in opposite directions, or they share an indirect relationship? So indirect means, or inverse relationship. It means if one is rising, the other one is falling. That means they move in opposite direction, right? So inflation and unemployment, they share an inverse relationship or negative relationship. If one rises, the other one falls. This is shown by Phillips curve. That means the Phillips curve is a downward sloping curve, a curve which moves, a curve which moves downwards from the left side to the right side, coming to the right side, right? So that shows you an inverse relationship. So if one is rising, the other one is falling, right? You can see here, inflation and unemployment have an inverse relationship. Higher inflation is associated with lower unemployment and vice versa. See, higher inflation related to lower unemployment, and higher unemployment, higher and lower inflation, sorry, cut. See, higher inflation is associated with lower unemployment. That means more employment. So if inflation rises, unemployment falls. And if inflation and if unemployment rises, inflation falls. So why do you think is such a relationship there? See, first we are going to discuss this part. If unemployment is rising, that means more people, they are not having work. If they do not have work, they do not have income. And if they do not have income, then they are not going to buy goods in the market. So what do you think? If you have a job, obviously you are going to shop more because you are earning money. And unemployed people, they cannot demand, they cannot generate demand in the economy, leading to fall in prices of goods and services and fall in inflation. So this relationship is satisfied. After that, if inflation rises, then it leads to a fall in the unemployment rate. So see, inflation is rising. That means the goods and the prices of goods and services, they are rising. If the prices are rising, that means there is demand, and there is demand. So the producers, they have to fulfill that demand. And in order to fulfill that demand, they would have to expand their manufacturing processes. In order to expand their manufacturing processes, they have to put up new plants, they have to invest more capital, and they need to hire more people. And when they need to hire more people, there is a reduction in unemployment because there is employment generation. That is why this part is also satisfied. So this is Phillips curve. So but this Phillips curve, it used to be very popular in the previous century, but now this is not very popular. And why is this so? We are going to discuss it. See, Phillips curve was a concept used to guide macroeconomic policy in the 20th century, but was called into question by a concept of stagflation of the 1970s. See, we are saying if inflation is rising, unemployment is falling, and unemployment is rising, inflation is falling. But there comes a concept of stagflation where inflation is rising and unemployment is also rising. So there is no demand, but still inflation is rising. So there is a concept of stagflation that can be due. So that can be due to supply side constraints that the producers, they are not able to easily manufacture products. That is why there is rise in prices, right? So if this relationship holds true, then where did stagflation come from? So that is why this Phillips curve is criticized when the stagflation came into the scene. So here you can see, we have discussed this part, how the relationship works. But with the outbreak of stagflation, there was criticism of Phillips curve and it was held into questions, right? So guys, these were the 5 questions for today. I hope you learned something new from this video. And if you did, then don't forget to hit the like button. I'll be back tomorrow with some new set of information. Until then, take care of your studies, take care of your health, and I'll see you tomorrow. Thank you.